Hello, everybody, and welcome to episode 5 of In the Group Chat.
Hello, hello.
Hello. A bit more louder, please.
Yes. It's my first podcast that I'm co-hosting. So.
Yeah, first of many. Today, we've got an extremely special guest, and we're going to find out very soon why. We have Loick in the building.
Thanks for having me.
Now, with all our episodes, we like to get to the nitty-gritty, but before we do all of that, Loick, introduce yourself. Tell us a little bit about you, what you do, what you're into.
Yeah.
I mean, you seem like an extrovert, no?
I don't know, it depends who I'm with. I feel like the older I get, the more introverted I get.
Yeah, it makes sense.
My friends will tell you that as well.
Yeah.
But yeah, I'm Loick Pires, 32, from Camden. Ex-footballer, now working in tech. My interests are drawing, reading, travelling, music, really like music, films, all of the above. And I guess we'll delve deeper into what makes up me.
Absolutely. But the way I'd like to start that as well. Initially, obviously, everything that you probably are today stems from somewhere.
Yep.
So tell us a little bit. Actually, before you do tell us, I just remembered. We've got a new segment.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, we have a segment.
Yeah.
So I thought it would be very interesting to start with a segment on every episode. And today's one is going to be... We're going to start with a segment, guys. If you lot knew the amount of times we've had to start and stop this, but it's all good. Yeah, it's part of the process. We're learning.
Mm-hmm.
The segment is going to be pick your poison.
Yeah.
So the first question is...
You should do them boom, boom, boom.
Oh, sounds. Yeah. Hopefully it's a boom, boom, boom one. Maybe not. Wrong button. Okay, no. We'll get back to you on that one.
Technical.
First,
still learning, it's fine.
Yeah, it's okay. I feel like the sounds on here change every time. It's really...
Yeah, they do, actually.
Anyway, it's a good part of the show. So the first one is, would you rather never play football in your life or never be able to watch football?
Never be able to watch football.
Ever. Like, you literally, to the day you die, because imagine you're 80 and you're like...
Oh, that's true.
You can't play.
I'll be playing though, mate.
Love that.
In one way, shape or form, I'll be doing kick-ups with my grandchildren. And the reason is, really, I've always loved playing as opposed to watching.
Mm-hmm.
The feeling of having the ball at my feet, doing skills, trying to better myself. Like, even when I was a pro, I hardly watched matches unless I was doing... homework on the opposition. Playing from the age of 9, 10 has always been my passion. So if you told me I couldn't do that and then watch football, it'd be a nightmare for me. So yeah.
So it's a no-brainer for
me. That's such a mature response.
I know.
It's true though. I went a few years without watching football anyway. I've just fallen back in love with watching it, but playing it has never
stopped. Who do you support? I feel like that's a big part in whether you like to watch or not.
I support Arsenal.
Well, there we go. That's that kind of...
Yeah.
I mean, it might make it easier never to watch them again.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, you need to tell everyone that we're back up because we're on top of the Premier League. Norwich will tell you that.
Yeah, I know. I hear every day.
Yeah, good. And you're going to keep hearing it every day.
For how long, though?
Yeah, let's see. Let's just enjoy the good times. They've broken my heart a few times.
But you know what? That's how you know guys are loyal if they support Arsenal, right? Exactly. I've heard.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Right, second one. Ronaldo or Messi?
Messi.
High five.
High five, yeah.
I agree with that as well.
But
I took a long
time. I need to state this and make it clear to everyone, just because you like one, it doesn't mean you're anti the other.
I agree. Yes.
There's a lot of people who have the Ronaldo and Messi debate. They have to like bitch about one to raise the other.
Yeah.
And I think it's a good lesson in life that just because you like one, you don't have to hate the other. And I think Messi's great and I think Ronaldo's great. For me, it's quite close.
Mm-hmm.
But Messi's the only footballer that's ever taken my breath away. When you talk about not watching football, he would be the one that I would miss not watching.
Yeah.
Because he does things like... Messi is what we call an alien and then there's the rest.
Yeah.
Ronaldo's the best of humans.
Yes.
Messi, what he does is...
That's a good way to put it.
Yeah, Messi, what he does with a ball is... It will never happen again, but we will get another Ronaldo, in my opinion.
I agree.
Yeah.
I mean, like, I'm not...
Mbappe, for me, is like the new Ronaldo.
Okay.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, but there will never be a new Messi, ever. He's 5'6", stronger than everyone.
Yeah.
Is like, he actually 5'6"?
No, I went to... Is it Camp Nou?
Yeah.
Sorry, okay.
Say it louder, believe in yourself.
Sorry, yeah. I went to Camp Nou in Barcelona, and they had, like, the measurements of people, and I was like, oh, my God, they have my height. And I look, and it was bloody Messi's height. I was like, how is this guy human?
Yeah. He's not, is the answer.
That's true. Like you said, he's alien.
Yeah.
I like him though. He's humble. I feel like Ronaldo is as well, but I feel like
you watch his documentary.
Messi is just like very, I don't know, his persona comes across a bit more relatable, I feel.
Yeah, I think you can see the characters. We were talking about introvert and extrovert. Messi's very much an introvert.
Yeah.
Keeps to himself, hardly posts on social media, yeah. Very family orientated. Cristiano Ronaldo is an extrovert. He's worked hard to get to where he's at. When I say he's the best of humans, he wasn't always that talented.
For sure.
He had to like get up to a level. And that's why he shouts about it. He's like, puts the hours in the gym and he's got the results for it. With Messi, it's like God-given talent.
Mm.
He was like that from the age of 12. He's worked at it, yes, but everything he has you can't teach. Where Ronaldo, he had to teach himself. So it's a good example of like two different personalities and how they go about showcasing their talent. So.
I wonder how they feel about like having this, you know,
I was just going to say, yeah, I feel like Messi needs a bit more credit in the sense of like, I'm pretty sure he worked very hard.
I know he has. And he might have worked as hard as Ronaldo, but he had...
He seems extraterrestrial, like in the way he plays.
Yeah, some people just got it and he's like maintained it.
Mm-hmm.
That's the hardest thing in life. You could get to the top of maintaining it for 15 years in football is unheard of.
Mm.
But Ronaldo, it's like he had to go from 0 to 100 and then maintain it. So not one is better than the other, but it's good.
Yeah,
it's a good
social
product.
Enjoy this, like, oh, is it Ronaldo or Messi or whether
they're cool though. I've seen like videos.
Yeah,
of them,
yeah, they're
like,
calm. I think Ronaldo is more affected by it than Messi because he's a bit more egotistical. Mm-hmm. When someone says Ronaldo's not good, he takes it to heart. Messi's like, whatever.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
It doesn't matter to me.
It is what it is.
It is what it is, exactly.
Next question, right? This one, hope Tanisha's not watching if you answer wrong. Would you rather score the winning goal for the World Cup and it's like your last match ever, you're retiring, right?
Yeah.
And you're the deciding factor for who would you play for, Portugal or England or whatever?
Let's go England.
Right. Or be at the birth of your child, but it's like your third child.
It's not my third child.
But you can make up a lie. Like,
No one will ever know.
I mean, they're watching you on TV, but imagine a world where no one will ever know that you missed your child's birth.
Except Tanisha.
Yeah.
Yeah, because she's given.
But maybe she. Yeah.
What, did they put a blindfold on her or something?
Yeah, like.
Will the answer change if she knows or doesn't know?
The answer will change. It's the World Cup final. It's the World Cup final.
Yeah, I'm gonna see my baby anyway.
What if he was your first child?
That's a different story.
I am dead.
No, I'm joking. I'd still World Cup final.
Do you know, it reminds me of the video of the guy that said,
yeah, there was a story about that.
Yeah, he was literally, it was the Euro finals, and he was like, this is more special than my child's
birth.
I
think I can get away with it because it's hypothetical, but I've dreamed of doing that since I was a young boy. Like, I used to pray before I slept, please God, make me the best player in the world, help me get to World Cup, help me get to Champions League. So hypothetically speaking, it'd be a hard decision.
Mm-hmm.
If you told me I can have that moment.
Yeah.
Because you're remembered forever.
It's true.
Yeah.
We got phones. T can film the birth.
It's cool. And your child's going to remember this forever.
Yeah.
Do you know what? I'll give my child the medal.
There we go.
Oh, yeah. That's
credit to the child.
That's true.
A lot of people.
Out of curiosity,
I feel like every guy's going to be like, yeah.
Yeah, inside they'll be like, babe, I'll never do that to you.
It's a hypothetical too, so, you know, by the time we have kids, I'll be late 30s, whatever, so it's not going
to happen. So it won't apply then, it's all right. Out of curiosity, who would you play for, like, national-wise?
Probably England, because I was born in France.
Oh, okay.
So the second one would probably be France.
Mm-hmm.
Portugal, I am Portuguese in blood, but... it's from my dad's side. I've been a handful of times. I still feel Portuguese, but England is where I spent most of my life. So England, if they don't like me, then France is a few I would have gone for.
Well, it's hypothetical, so they would like you.
I hope so.
Right. Where is the next one? Next one is, so you bench for Arsenal, so you don't get to play.
Yeah.
But you're part of the team.
Yeah.
Or, let me be nice, like you play a friendly here and there. Or, right, you're the main man at Tottenham. Like Gareth Bale, main man, when he was...
You've done your research.
Oh, no, I was... In my family, I was basically the boy. Like, I used to watch football with my dad all the time.
These are good questions. I need to get you on my podcast. I never like to be a side man, so I play for Tottenham. with an Arsenal shirt underneath my
can't do that.
Yeah, since who?
Well, to be fair,
that's true.
That's true.
And a lot of footballers have played for teams that they don't support.
Don't like, yeah. Yeah, that's true.
And I'd rather be a main man than on the bench, even if it's for a team I support.
Yeah, sorry. Yeah. Give me the bag.
Exactly.
I wonder if all Arsenal
fans... On top of that, if I'm on the bench, am I going to make the World Cup squad to score that goal?
Exactly.
Okay, you've got to think ahead.
That's true. You know, smart thinking. That's why you're on here, Loick. Yeah. Come on. Right, and next one is, you earn a considerable amount a year, but you only have 2 weeks annual leave from your job. So look, or having a very extremely average salary, but like your working hours are ideal, your holidays are completely like whenever you fancy. Which one would you prefer?
So you're talking like 20k, but like unlimited holiday. Yeah.
Okay, maybe not. Put 20K, some like, let okay, what about 30k?
30k, yeah.
30k.
Yeah, compared to
because
how much?
Do you know what? To England, 30k is basically £30. Because yeah, I've already wasted £100 just by walking out my door for some reason.
100%, I agree.
Compared to 200k.
Yeah.
But you have like 2 weeks off.
I would take the 200k job,
mm-hmm.
stack for a year or two, and then leave. Take a long holiday. I would have enough money to take that holiday. And then
you're finding a loophole to every question.
I know, right?
Dang it.
Yeah.
That's a good one.
Imagine being in an argument with me. I'm not going to win.
Well, good luck.
He wins all the time, so I'm funny here, honestly.
There we go. And the last one is, travel the world, but you can never come back to England, or stay that in England option. Forever, but you can never leave.
Wait, what?
So basically, you travel the world, like, but you can never come back to England. Like, England is off limits. You'll never ever be able to...
That's an option.
Oh, okay, cool. Yeah. Then that'll be my option too.
Why would you want to come back here?
That's true.
If you want to see family, just like make them fly out.
Yeah, true, exactly. Yeah, and I'm doing 200k a year, so.
Exactly.
That's true. That's true.
2 weeks they can come.
Exactly.
So, well, that's the end of our segment. I hope you enjoyed it.
Yeah, some research
right into
it.
I love that.
Have me thinking.
Right, so let's get to the nitty gritty, Elzar.
Let's.
Yeah. Right. So, as you. Like, probably know, guys, I like to dig a little bit deep, find out what made you who you are, the person today. And basically, I just want to know what were maybe the attributes or the things that maybe happened in your life that accumulated all these characteristics and, like, attributes that make Loick who he is today. You're probably, like, your pre-teens the main pinnacle moments in your life.
Yeah, 100%. Where do I start, really? I guess, well, first of all, I was born in Paris, and I came here when I was 6, 7. So, I guess, when I came here, I always had a bit of an outsider mentality. Like, I had to work harder to be accepted, had to learn a new language.
Can you speak French, by the way?
Yeah, fluently. Yeah. So, I guess that was my makeup of my early years. And then on top of that, moving here, lost my dad when I was quite young. And he was quite young as well.
Wow.
So I had to process that in my early years. And then I had a great mum. I had a younger brother. And I guess I was just, if I have my earliest memories in England, it was just finding myself, trying to fit in.
Mm.
And I guess I did a good job of that. But there was always a part of me that just felt like an outsider.
Mm-hmm.
I went to school with people who had loads of networks. I joined the secondary school, and then there was people who knew each other from primary school that I didn't know. And secondary school, first couple of years were a bit tough because, again, I just didn't have an outlet. I didn't feel like I had my personality because I wasn't surrounded by people that could bring out who I am.
Mm-hmm.
And then I started playing football. Well, before I started playing football, I was quite an angry teen. All this confusion about, like, coming from another country, not having a stable network of friends, again, feeling like an outsider, and obviously processing what happened when I was younger with my dad. I felt like there was a lot of anger in me. Not angered, like, towards people, but just...
Inside, like boiling up,
So I used to get into a lot of fights. I never used to start them, but I used to be... Now I can say it because you're allowed to be less macho, but I used to be quite sensitive. People used to say stuff to me, and I didn't just used to say anything back. I just used to push them, or, like, if they used to push me, I used to get into fights. And I had to find something to channel that rage, or just to access, like, what's going on with me? Why am I so angry all the time? And that's where football was a very good outlet. Like, there was a youth club at Haverstock, my secondary school in Camden, and there was a club in Swiss Cottage. I don't know if you're familiar with that.
Yeah.
Which was really good. And this coach took me in. He said, look, you're a really talented footballer. You're a bit greedy with the ball. You keep to yourself. You don't really talk to your teammates, but you've got a bit of talent. I'm going to teach you how to be in a team. I'm going to teach you how to be around other people. And he taught me so many life skills that helped me today. So once I joined the football team, a lot of my rage settled. I got into less fights. My energy, I was very energetic. I was very much an extrovert as a teenager. But the football just helped, like, channel that energy. And once I found I was good at it, and once I was watching matches when I was younger, so if you asked me that question when I was younger, I would have said watching matches, because obviously I used to love watching footballers. But once I realised I was good at it, I just dreamed of being a professional footballer. And that's the first time I found out a raw personality trait in myself, where if I have a goal, if I want to do it, I will get it. Nothing will stand in my way. Tunnel vision. So by the time I was in year 10, 11, I was pretty much better than everyone else. I got scouted for a team. I joined Stoke, which is north of the country, at 16. So I left after year 11, left my family home, went to Stoke for a year. And that was a really eye-opening experience. Like, it shaped who I was in terms of being a survivor. Because there's a lot of people from up north, and they're harsher. Like, we think we're harsh in London. These people, yeah, like, the way they joke about you, the way they... It felt like moving into another country again, like when
like
I first
a culture shock.
Yeah, it was a big culture shock. So that really shaped my football career, in that I realised this dog eat dog. These guys are fighting for contracts. You hardly make friends in football. Everyone's fighting for your spot. So I went to Stoke for a year, came back, joined a team in East London called Leyton Orient. And out of about 60 boys, two of us got professional contracts, and I was one of them. So that was a dream come true. Hardly in life you can say a dream come true. I became a professional footballer.
That's literally like one in a million, right?
Yeah, 100%. Like, you got boys growing up, they either want to be rappers, singers, musicians, footballers, something in the media or whatever. If you're talking about a competitive market, football is a competitive market. Norwich speaks about it all the time. My brother, everyone. Like, so when I made it, it was a great feeling, but also I knew this was the start of a very lonely journey, because at 18, I'm going to play football, I'm staying home all the time, eating my pasta, you know, watching games, like, and all my friends are going uni, going out, they're building memories, all these friendships, all of that, and I'm sitting at home. So the friends I had made, worked so hard to make in secondary school, just drifting apart from me, because it's a completely different world. On Friday nights, they're out, I've got a match on Saturday morning. So that was another stage in my life that shaped me, and it was quite lonely. But again, that's secondary to the goal of me wanting to be a footballer, wanting to score in a World Cup final, wanting to, you know, play for Arsenal. So between 18 to 25, I hardly used to drink. Like, I can count on one hand the amount of times I drank or went out to a nightclub. And all my friends, by the time they were 25, they've got all these memories of going on holiday together and all of that. And then I'd meet up with them, and there's just all these inside jokes, and I don't really feel connected. I'm an outsider again. So
it's like two stages of being an outsider. Yeah, as soon 100%. As you build like a bit of identity, you go somewhere else.
Coming here, my teens, in part, well, primary school, and then obviously my early 20s. So yeah, it was just like, oh, this is kind of happening again. But the dream outweighed. Like,
did you make friends in the football club?
Hardly.
Was like, everyone
insane
to themselves?
Well, you make friends, but it's like fake friendships. I compare it to
surface value. Like,
yeah. Like, you see, for example, someone gave an example. Like, I picked up T and her friend Caro from a party where they saw Love Island people.
Yeah.
There. And they said it was very, like, surface-level friendships. Like, look like they're friends, but really they've got the ultimate goal to be the best influencer, to be the most seen person, whatever. Football's very much like that as well. Like, you make friendships at a very surface level. If a manager says they want to pick that person will do anything for that manager and walk all over you as well. That's just the way football is. You see 11 players on the pitch, but the politics behind it's mad. I can count on one hand the real friends I've made from football that I still keep in touch with.
Wow.
Yeah. That's how it is.
That's
honestly
so sad.
Yeah. So then you've got no friends in football, and then you've got like your weakening friendships outside of it. So it's a very lonely world. And on top of that, when you're injured, which towards the end of my career, I was quite injured. My leg was broken, everything.
God.
Yeah. You just spend a lot of time alone. So yeah, like, it was a great 9-10 years, by the way. Like, but then it ended when I was 25, and then I had to find something new to do with my life.
Did you end it yourself, or did it just come to an end?
It was a mixture of both. So I broke my leg and I came back for a year and I just wasn't the same. I compare it to like a pianist trying to play with eight fingers. You still can, but it's not the same. Yeah. Do you know what I mean? So in the end, I was playing for clubs. It was my only source of income. So I was just, I had a good reputation, but I'd get at a club and we see, you're not the Loick we thought you'd be. And I'd stay there for 6 months and then go to a club that knew of the old me and then just keep chasing a paycheck. And I was tarnishing my name, all my legacy that I'd done for 9-10 years. And then I got to a point where I'm like, I'm playing at 10%, I need to stop and I need to find something new. And that journey was, yeah, that was something else, but we'll get into
it. I was going to say, like, did the uncertainty kind of haunt you a little bit? Because, you know, with football, you never know what's going to happen. Like, 100%. you were injured, so did that kind of just make you maybe firm the loneliness during the time that you were lonely?
Yeah.
Or did you just think that you were always going to be like a footballer until like you're 35?
Yeah, I thought I was going to be a footballer until I was like 34-35. That was always the plan. So then when it was coming to an end back then, so this was what, 7-8 years ago, there wasn't a lot of resources for footballers who were injured or at least retiring. You had two options: either become a PT or be a coach. I didn't want to be either, but they paid for my PT course. I became
Don't want to be the next Zidane.
Nah. If I'm to do coaching, I'd rather do one-to-one coaching, which I've been doing. Okay. I'll get into that in a bit. I wouldn't mind being an ex Zidane, but let's see.
In a hypothetical world, you can be anything.
Yeah, you can be anything.
100%. You can score the winning goal and then, like, coach the best team in the world.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. It's always an option. But in the end, I took the PT course that they paid for me. And I did PT in whilst my career was ending. And I absolutely hated it. Like,
really?
Back then, and no shade to PTs, but, like, the PTs I was surrounded by or the industry was just meatheads. No scientific knowledge about the body. Get hench or die trying. Fitness this.
How long ago was that?
This was in 2013, 2014.
Yeah, I feel like it's kind of changed now. The whole
It's developed 100%. It's gotten better now, but back then, and I guess maybe it was just the circle of like PTs as footballers as PTs or whatever. But it was just not an industry I wanted to be in. I felt I was a bit like smarter than that. It was just like protein madness back then, which I hated. So I did that, and I worked in Gymbox in bank. Guess how much rent was, because you have to pay rent as a PT. Yeah.
In bank, that's going to be expensive.
I don't know, like,
what, a month?
Yeah, you pay rent for the space, and then 500? Once you pay that, you make money on top.
Like, $2,000?
$1,200.
That's rent.
And for a new PT... Crazy. You have to do that to break even, and then you make money on top. I was making 1,400, which means I was taking out 200, which was paying for my lunch and then my travel, if that, back then. So
How long did you do that for?
I lasted 6 months.
Yeah,
I
was
burning. That's a long time.
I was burning through my savings, honestly. And for them, it doesn't matter. It's a revolving door.
Yeah, exactly.
Every new PT's like, oh, like, new space. And then they last 3 months and leave, So then I had a second PT job, and I worked for a retired Olympic cyclist who had a bunch of people he PT'd, but he couldn't do it all, so he gave me a cut of his sessions if I PT'd for him. I did that for about 6 weeks, and then he wouldn't pay me. Didn't hear from him. He went back to Australia. I did about 7-8 weeks worth of work. Didn't pay me. Started texting him. I said, look, if you don't pay me, I'm going to come to your gym with a baseball bat and smash it up. Like, I was threatening him. Not usually like that. It was an empty threat, but I was like, bro,
you have to pay me.
On top of that, I was living at my auntie's at this time. My auntie was charging me £150 to stay at a place in Canning Town. I couldn't even afford that. That's how down I was on money. And I'd spent my last of my savings as a footballer on a car. So luckily I had a car. I spent about £5,000 on a car. But I had no money, basically. And this guy wouldn't pay me. Never heard from him again. I didn't hear from him again for like 3 or 4 months. He did pay me in the end, but by then I'd left. And I remember being in that room at my auntie's thinking, I can't even afford £150 to stay here. What the fuck is going on in my life? Am I not sweating?
Knock yourself out.
So yeah, that's where I had a real like, that was a real pivotal moment in my life. I'm like, I can't depend on any job that depends on my body or depends on like relying on someone to pay for me or doing something I don't love. Like, I'm literally sitting in this house, can't afford $150 a month. Fucking embarrassing.
Mm-hmm.
What the hell am I going to do in my life? So that's when I was like, I'm giving. I love to read. I love all of that. But how can I monetize something? And I applied for so many entry-level sales jobs at tech companies. I think I did like 20, 30 applications, and it was all no, because my CV was kicking a ball around for it.
Yeah.
Who's going to want to hire me, right? Yeah. And then, don't know if you heard of the website Read.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, UK, yeah. Website.
So,
oh, I've probably sent 30 in that myself as well.
Well, like, I got through an interview stage with them, and it looked like they were going to say no. So I was just like, guys, look, I will work for free. Please, like, I need this. And they're like, look, we can't legally do that. You're too old for an internship, but we really like you. You're really approachable. We'll give you a chance. Like, they gave me a 20K job. And I was like, what, 25, 26? And it's usually a job they give to someone when they fresh out of uni.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But I saw this as a massive opportunity. I'm like, okay, cool. This is a salary job. That door's closed. Football, PT, all of that. No, I can't even put football and PT in the same door. Mm-hmm. Football's closed, PT in the bin. Onto this new job kind of thing. And then within the first like month, I wasn't better than anyone, but it was a telesales role, and I just used my football initiative, and I was like, today I'm going to score 100 goals. But what 100 goals means, I'm going to call 100 people, and I'm not going to stop until I call 100 people. And I was just doing that every day, calling 100 people, do you need advertising space, blah blah blah. Within like 3 months I got promoted, and they didn't, like, I wasn't better than anyone, I just had that serious work ethic in football.
It's like that thing that you said, when you're not like an expert or the best at something, you're just good at loads of things, and then
you stay consistent at
you go for it, and then, like you said,
how did that feel though? Because obviously you went from pro footballing to PT, and you've got, you're at gym box, and then you've obviously gone to a sales role where you're picking up the phone. Did that feel very uncomfortable for you?
It felt uncomfortable, and it felt like there was a loads of emotions, because first thing when people think of football is you've got loads of money.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know what I mean? I was playing at a level where even if you quit, you're not going to be financially free. It's only the Premier League there, and in like hundreds of grand a week. I was on a modest salary as a footballer in a way, but I didn't care about that because I was making a dream come true. I was a young player playing football. So you had to overcome questions, people saying, oh, like, what happened in football? How come you need to work? Like, I'm like, well, no, I need to work, obviously.
Yeah.
I didn't want to stay in football or coaching or PTing. So I had to get over that, not embarrassment, but had to be ready for those lines of questioning. Yeah. And then coming into the new job, there was a bit of uncomfortableness, but it was the first experience of something outside of my comfort zone. I was saying that to you just outside. It's the first, one of the few times in my life I really grew in a short space of time, because I was doing something I never had done before, but it was pushing me to a space where I have to do this, I have to be successful at this, because it's a good opportunity. So yes, I was uncomfortable, but I was growing as I was uncomfortable. So,
and did the adjustment from, like, obviously you're going to train for the game, now you're putting your suit on, going into the office from 9 a.m. was that very hard for you to get into?
100%, because it wasn't a passion. Everything I was doing up until this point in life was a passion. I didn't need to be motivated for it. It was automatic. I get up, play football, I train, I go gym. Everything is for the goal of being the best that I can be for the team, for myself. Whereby here I knew it was an opportunity, but I had to find something in myself to motivate myself. But the motivation was that I need to make a new career out of this. I've got a fantastic opportunity, albeit it's an entry-level sales role, but I have to make this work, because I remember being in that dark room with my aunt where I couldn't afford $150 a month, not knowing what I would do next. And I was just like, yeah, I've got to make this work.
Sorry to cut you off, but I just wanted to know, do you think there's a correlation? Because I know, like, for myself, how I feel, but do you think there's a correlation of being that immigrant child and having that hustle mentality 100%. And that survival mode, you just like switch it on? I don't know if it's embedded in us or why, but even like studies show that immigrants, they are a lot less fearful when it comes to changing bandwagons and getting into that momentum of, you know what, I don't know what the future holds, but what I'm gonna make do with what I've got, and I'm gonna like just get the ball rolling.
10 toes into it, 100%. You've hit the nail on the head there, because my mum, when she came here at the age of what, she was 25, 7, she was 26, didn't speak the language, 2 kids, she used to work 3 jobs. You've heard this before, but I remember seeing that as a youngster, and I learned so much from my mum, not just as a person, but as a woman. Like, I'm so pro-women because of my mum, because the things she had to do, learn a language, all these jobs, we moved from house to house.
Sorry, can you just press that on there? So I'm not cutting. Thank you.
Yeah, you're on low battery.
It's all right.
yeah, we've moved from house to house. Like, everything she did, the power and strength she had to do that, that was definitely embedded in me, whether it's genetics, whether it's nature or nurture, I don't know. But there is definitely a hustle mentality from people who are not from here or get here against all odds.
Mm-hmm.
You identify an opportunity and you take it. You know it's not ever been handed to you, and you know you have to work twice as hard as the next person. So adversity brings out the best in us. Adversity is the reason our parents came. My mom came from Congo because there was a lot of war. She went from Congo to France. She went from France to here for her safety, for her kids' safety. I know from your background as well.
Same, identical.
Do you know what I mean? Like, and whilst you might have not gone through it directly, your parents did, and that's offsetting to you.
Yeah.
So you know opportunities you get, you make the most of them.
Yeah.
So that's definitely embedded in immigrants. And I'm proud to be an immigrant, 100%. I'm proud that my mum is. I wasn't proud when I was younger.
Yeah, I was just mortified about it. But before it's like, oh God, it's just had this whole stigma behind it.
Yeah, 100%. Yeah. It shapes who you are, right?
It definitely does. Yeah.
Oh, 100%.
I mean, like I was saying on our last episode about like when you literally don't have a choice, like you're saying, you're at your aunt's house, you can afford 150 a month. Like when you have no choice, there is no other
choice that you have to go and do it, there is no other option, so you just have to do it.
And I had to make that work. I had to. There's a lot of these guys working with me who came from uni, who had parents who could support them if it went wrong. My mom's always supporting me in terms of like emotional and that stuff, but financially it's been hard for all of us. So I knew if I didn't make that work, I'd be back to square one. So even if I didn't like it, I didn't have a choice.
Yeah.
And in the end, my work ethic got me to where I am today. I'm working for a huge tech firm. I've got great connects, great networks, great experiences.
Say it with your chest.
I know, honestly, you were telling me about it the other day. I was just amazed by what you were saying with what your work is and how you've built this massive connection.
Yeah, I'm lucky in some sense, but I have definitely made my own luck.
Yeah, for sure.
And I've learned a lot of life lessons. But yeah, back to that first job, 100%, I had no choice but to make it work.
Mm.
And if it didn't work for me, then I would have to find something equally as good. And on top of that, with that experience, I've tried to help people who are transitioning thing as well. So
how did you get from like I'm fighting to the moment of, oh my God, I've got this, like this is it kind of thing, the kind of life-changing moment of, it might have not felt as that's my life-changing moment, but do you remember a time where you were like, I've finally kind of got myself where I needed to be in a way where it's like the first step forward?
100%. I'll be honest with you, there's always a part of me that's always fighting. That's
Do you even feel that?
Yeah. And I know where you're coming from. I have got to stages in my career where I'm like, you know what, I am good at this. But there's always that little voice inside my head saying, I've got to keep fighting.
Yeah.
I've got to keep acting like I can have nothing tomorrow.
Because
it could all change. We saw that with lockdown. I've seen that with certain jobs where teams have changed. They've laid off some people, whatever. I'm definitely in a point in my life where I have the confidence to walk into a room and get what I want.
Yeah.
But that comes from a place of, I need to fight for what I want. So it's a blend of both. That I am in a comfortable space where I know I'm doing well, but I'm also, there's always someone trying to fight for my seat.
But you've also got the accolades now that when you do walk into that room, you present something that someone can't say no to.
100%. And me and T, ironically, were talking about this yesterday, and we were saying that once someone gives us an interview for something, we will get that job.
Yeah.
T is the same. Like, we've just got that same mindset. There was my job before this one, they offered me a 3% pay rise, which inflation is 7-8%. I'd be losing money if I'd stay. Instead of staying, I was just like, you know what? Thank you, but I'm going to find something new. I had two interviews. Both interviews, as I got in there, I knew I'd get both jobs.
That's amazing.
Not because I'm this amazing person, just because I'm true of what I say, and I'm confident in how I say it. And also, one thing that I've learned, that I don't know everything, and I shouldn't be ashamed to say that.
Yeah.
First thing I said to them, I'm not an expert in the field that you're recruiting for, but I could learn quickly and I'll be an asset to your team. Tell me what you need from me. That's what I said to them, and they're like, they were gobsmacked.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? I got an offer from LinkedIn, and then I got an offer from this place I'm working at now. And that's simply because of my experience and knowing that if I'm myself, it can work. And if it doesn't, on to the next one. So be it.
Yeah.
So, definitely.
Do you prefer the structured life now a little bit more to like the unstructured?
What, so
like
football?
Yeah. Well, I don't know. I'm sure that was structured.
Disciplinedly.
I know what you mean. Like, but nine to five.
It's just a bit, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, 100%. Preference isn't a word I would use, but I've accepted it, and I'm in a very fortunate position. Like, there's a lot of people out there without any jobs, or jobs that they're unhappy with, or experiences in life that they can't change. But for me right now, I'm in a happy place. I've accepted the fact that my football career is over. I do play Sunday League, but it's not the same. But I do other things that keep me within that footballing world, that when I go back to a 9-to-5, I feel satisfied. So I don't know if you know, I do some sports adverts. I'm part of a sport agency.
I was about to ask you about
that. Yeah, I was going to. I've got my favourite question here.
Are you allowed to say who you just...
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
Do you want to speak about that then?
So I was a pro footballer and then a semi-pro footballer. And when I was a semi-pro footballer, there was an advertising agency called Sports on Screen. And they provide choreography, body doubles, extras and models for shoots that involve football. So it can be any company. It could be BMW, it could be Sainsbury's. If they've got a football
scene...
Did I
see you with Pepsi? Was it...
Pepsi, yeah. Ronaldinho. Yeah,
I saw that.
That's really cool. But it's mostly football drinks companies, but basically I've been a part of the agency for like 10 years. So then when football ended, I was still part of that industry.
This must
there.
Be so, so like, nice, yeah. Yeah, really yeah. refreshing and nice to like still kind of like...
Yeah, be in touch with it a little bit. And obviously I get to meet some great players and have some great experiences.
I saw you. Yeah. I saw your recent post as well.
You've met so many people.
Yeah. And I'm very fortunate again, but I feel like they keep bringing me back because... I don't know, we work with a lot of footballers, and footballers obviously get treated like celebrities by most people.
Get treated like royalty.
Yeah, but they're very uncomfortable with that when you talk to them.
Mm-hmm.
But if you talk to them as people, which this agency does and what I do as well, you just have a good time and they come back to you, they want to work with you, and you get the best adverts as well. So I've been a part of that. I've done body doubles for loads of players, Varane, Ronaldinho, Dele Alli, and this is body double, so I don't have to look like them.
You just have to have
the same build from
physique,
a distance. Yeah. So I've done a few names. I've done Pepsi, I've done Shaw, I've done Betway, I've done Coca-Cola, Puma, Adidas, Nike. Arsenal as well. Ronaldinho. I don't know how that happened because I'm 4 inches taller than him. But again, power of manifestation. I kind of hate that word nowadays, but I can't think of another word.
Right, I know what you mean as well. Yeah. With that word.
It's become kind of trendy to say that now.
I feel like with our backgrounds, when you say the word manifestation, it's just like it doesn't sit right with me in the sense because everything that I've ever done, and I'm sure it's the same for you guys, it hasn't happened because you've said tomorrow I am going to be, or
it's a bit more than that.
I know, but for me,
you
like,
speak it into existence.
Yeah, but like, let's say for example, in my head I said, oh, I'm gonna lose weight, but I don't go gym.
Yeah.
Like, that's how I maybe because I like joke around with the word, I don't take it as seriously.
I think it has been gentrified, definitely. Like you say, it is speaking it into existence. I see manifestation as you're speaking about it, it's the first seed planted, but then you've got to have a plan of action to fulfill that.
Okay, yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
It's not
just, oh yeah, this is going to fall into my lap. So a good example I could give is that it's not always been plain sailing with the agency, in that there's been a long period of time where I've not had work. They've gone for younger people. I'm 32. They usually go for up-and-coming footballers. But there was a stage in lockdown where I used to just get my ball out. I don't know if you used to see the clips on the balcony I used to do. I started a page, LPFC, and I just started kicking the ball around and doing reels and doing videos just to inspire people to play, but just to show that I'm still about it.
Mm-hmm.
And then from doing that, I knew I had at the back of my head Sports on Screen would be watching, and I just plowed out content, and suddenly they just started calling me again. So that was a manifestation. I wanted more work. Mm-hmm. I wanted to show that I'm still in love with football and I still want to monetize it, still want to do something about it. And because of the work I put in, they've called me, and I've done Ronaldinho and all that stuff since. So manifestation, yes, is real. And the first part is speaking it, but you have to push through it.
Yeah, the full effect is actually putting the thing into practice. Yeah.
It's not just saying, oh yeah, bless me with something, please, and just sitting there.
I feel like now that's what it's become. That's why when I say that
word,
I feel
very... courses you can pay for to learn how to manifest.
See, that I wouldn't pay for that, personally.
I can't buy into that.
Same.
I
know, yeah. But a lot of people claim by it, because it's not just like you speak.
Isn't that like kind of like a, what's the word, the placebo effect?
Yeah.
Well, it depends, because obviously I imagine in the course that they speak about, for example, like, what is it that you want, you write it down, and then you plan on how you're going to do it, and then every day you wake up, you're like, I'm going to do it, and then automatically your body just kind of does it, because your brain's told your body, like, you're going to do it.
Yeah.
Because if you wake up every day and you tell yourself, you know, something negative, then you're just
put that
in your mindset, so your body's just not reacting with your brain, kind of thing.
And you've raised a good point there, because at the end of the day, I think for me personally, personal experience, manifestation's a mentality. If you succumb to the fact that you might be a victim of your circumstance or a victim of this, and you continue to own victimhood, which me and T talked about the other day, so I'm not going to claim I came up with that, but if you own like victimhood, then I see it like as an energy, though. You're closing the door on things that can come into your life, because people sometimes see you at face value. And if you're walking, as an example, I'll give you a really good example. The last shoot that I did, I was maybe the oldest by 5 or 6 years. There was 70% of them, it was their first shoot. We were shooting with Arsenal, and we were doing this one scene. It was a corner scene, so they're kicking the ball from one part of the pitch to another. We did about 40 or 50 takes. This was near the end of the day. And in between the takes, we'd have 2 or 3 minutes rest. Some of the young boys there were complaining. They were like, oh my god, this is so repetitive, why are we keep doing this, I want to go home, whatever. I looked at them thinking, you can be doing something so much worse right now. You can be scanning food items as a cashier in Sainsbury's, not knocking anyone who's doing that, but a lot of people don't want to be doing that. But you're here playing football with Arsenal, shooting an advert, doing what you love. Yes, it's repetitive, but like, you could be doing something else. And they all looked at me like, you know what, brother, you're right, you know, you're right. I'm like, yeah, I'm right. Like, I know this is your first, like, when we're young, like, we think, like, sky's the limit, but
on top of that. It's good to give that, like, perspective.
It made me feel old, but I was like, you know what, someone said this to me when I was younger, this is my time to say it to them. And, yeah, and I was like, look, on top of that, if your body language, if you're sulking, do you reckon they're going to call you back?
Exactly. No,
they're
not.
You've got to look like you're enjoying it to the end. And appearances are everything. And that's you manifesting a second, third, fourth gig. But a lot of people can't see outside of themselves sometimes. They go with the feeling that they feel. And that's why mentorship is so important. People who have been there, done that, can tell you how to do it. I think it's really important.
Yeah,
as long
as
there's the right person telling you.
For sure, because I feel like when, like, you have those thoughts in your head, realistically speaking, you have one thought, which is yours, and you're not really going to argue with yourself, or you never see the other side, because you only have your feeling to account
for. Or you argue with yourself so much that you don't even know what
to do. Literally, you're so indecisive. So it's nice to have someone, for example,
to reassure you and remind you of
100%.
The good
stuff. And that's the importance of friends and your circle. And sometimes you have to have a separate, like, business circle.
Yeah, for sure.
Do you know what I mean? Not having an echo chamber, people who tell you something different that you think about, but not putting you down, kind of thing, but just telling you from their experience. And then you take from it what you want. You don't have to completely take what they say, but having a good core network that can help you with that is so key.
I mean, I do mentoring on the side as well for people who I've mentioned before, people who are doing entrepreneurship or have got a business that they've started up. So I've noticed, because even back in the day when I used to do fundraising, like, on the street, I don't want to speak about that, but honestly, it taught me so much, because I would team lead a big team, and I was telling you this the other day, but, like, the energy you bring to your team is so important, because if I came there and I've had a bad morning, blah, 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 and I'm, like, sulking, my team are going to go out there and literally just not do any good, because I've given that energy to them, and as soon as they're, like, team leader is bringing that energy, they just go away with that.
Yeah.
Whereas there would be times that's happened, because, you know, you're only human, you can't be happy every single time. But there'll be times that that's happened, and I'd have someone on my team who's got really big energy, and I'm like, oh my god, come on, like, you've got to, this is what you need to bring. And there'll be other times, for example, like, I'd come in and it's like the last half an hour, we've got no sign-ups, and I'm like, oh my god, what do we do? I can either sulk at them or come with them with this big energy, really hype them up, and make sure that even though the whole day no one's got a sign up, by the end of it, like, you've still got half an hour, like, there is still something you can do. And when you give someone that push, that, like, re-energize, whether you re-energize them, I feel like It could be related to like football, even.
100%.
Yeah, like they go out there.
Coach. Yeah, they're like 6-0 down. You're like, bro, come on, like, do this.
Anything's possible. And I kid you not, when I'd bring that energy, when I'd go out, they'd go out there like dancing on their spot, dancing around. And then that person will see that person, and that person sees the other person, and they're all just, you know.
I think you noticed the difference though, when you were being that, like, a bit more dull.
Yeah, definitely. Because then they'd go get sign ups, and like, that's what it takes, is for you to kind of like get that person to feel reassured, and like, just because it's coming to the end of the day and you can't be bothered anymore, you might as well utilize that half an hour to, you know, do something. Yeah. You're going to be standing in that position anyway, so you might as well do the best you can rather than just stand and get bored.
Sometimes you just need to be told by someone who's been there before.
Obviously, I couldn't agree more. I feel like with that, sorry to cut you off, with that, I prefer that, in the sense, because I know you've experienced it, then 9 times out of 10 it must be true. And I always say, if I want the most raw advice, I either go to my sister, and I'll go to my parents, or like, you know, my friends that I know don't have any like interest towards me, where they're not gonna like capitalize off me in that sense, because I know they'll give me the truth of how it is. So I just think that is so true, like having even after work as well, you're not like a switch where, oh, okay, you had a really bad day at work, you carry that over as well. So that last half an hour that you amped everyone up gives you kind of that little boost in everyone else, so when they go home they don't feel a bit dull and down in the dark. So it just feels
100%. That was a really nice moment on the advert to pass it on to them. I think it's so important for younger people to have role models, or at least people they can look up to that's like them, which right now, obviously in tech, there's not a lot of black guys, not a lot of black people. So my aim eventually is to obviously have my own business, all of that, but to be so known in the tech world that I can open doors for people who are like me, or at least who would want to be mentored by someone that's like me.
That's amazing.
That's what, you can always pass on what you can, and it's something I could have done
why
well.
Why wouldn't you want to as well, do you know what I mean? Like, you've got all this knowledge and like expertise, it must feel so nice and fulfilling as well to like teach someone else. Or
100%. And another thing I was doing in lockdown was I was doing mentorship to young footballers. So there's a lot of, obviously, a lot of good work being done with mental health in football, but there's still a long way to go. And a lot of clubs are recruiting sports psychologists, for example. But a lot of these sports psychologists are psychologists by nature. They're not ex-sportsmen. So footballers don't really warm to them. But what I found when I was speaking to young footballers is that they were listening to me because they know I've been through it. So I think in any walk of life, if you are to help people, just make sure it's on the path that you've been on. So that your experience that you're passing on is genuine. And that's when people warm to you the most, from my experience. So both in the tech world and football world, if I can help people as much as I can, then I will.
Just the way you come across, because obviously you've come to the point of feeling really confident, you go into an interview like, I'm gonna get this interview. For people watching, I'm sure that they would want to know how. I know you don't have like a moment where you're like, this is it kind of thing, but like, what's something that you've taken away from your experience that has led you to the point of, I know that I'm gonna get this interview? Because it's a scary world out there.
It's a scary world, get a job. And it's getting harder now, because we could all hide behind social media, like you've got dating apps where you can build a profile or persona of yourself who you might not be, and then you meet people and you're like, oh. I really worry for the future of like teenagers when they get into interviews, because their social skills are getting a bit less. But I guess my advice would just be, don't be afraid to be imperfect. Like, when people are looking at you, they're not looking for the finished article usually. They're looking for someone who has a capacity to learn, but also a capacity to be themselves. They don't want robots, most of these places. So show your personality, show that you've done your research, and show that you are willing to be part of a team, but also you're going to bring something new to the table. And just don't be afraid to stutter, don't be afraid to like stumble over your words. People can sense if you're being yourself or not. And I can't say that highly enough. Everyone's unique. I know it's a cliche, but like, I can't, like, just...
It's okay to like... You know, sometimes when interviews, when you get struck by a little bit with a question, you're like,
it's okay to say,
can I take a second as well? And I've realized that I've done that once before, and honestly, it helped me so much.
100%. Yeah, I mean, I've been on the recruiting end where I've recruited people, and what you're saying is so true. I can sense when someone's not being themselves, like from the way they just say hi or they introduce themselves. And if you ask them questions, like you're saying, I'm not looking for you to give me the perfect answer. I'm just trying to get to know you. Is your energy going to vibe with this company? Like, are we going to be good for you? 100%. So when people are trying to like give me the perfect answer, I'm just like...
Yeah. And one thing people who are hiring or companies who are hiring look for is an attitude.
Yeah.
Sorry, not an attitude, that's not right. Is attitude, yeah. Sorry. Because you can't teach attitude. You can't teach someone to work hard. You can teach people skills. You can't teach someone to work hard. You can't teach someone to be themselves. You can't teach... I think the more you bring that out, the better it'll be for you.
I don't know. Do you think now it's like really scary? Because social media is so... has basically taken over the world. I can't imagine... Well, I mean, obviously we're young enough where social media was still like really popular when we were going through our interview experiences, but I can't imagine like my younger sister now, how she would feel going into an interview room, because I feel like the skills that we had were slightly a bit more raw and like practice based, whereas now everything is behind a computer. Would you...
Honestly, like, you've raised such a good point, which I speak of quite a lot, where we're the last generation where we still had human interaction on a regular level. Like, you used to go out and see your friends all the time, like, you'd go to the park, you'd go Tinseltown, whatever, you'd be amongst people. I used to go to my friends to play computer games, now it's all done online.
Yeah.
Do you know how much character building that was to be around your friends playing computer games? Around different people all the time. You'd lose games, people take the mick out of you, you build life social skills, you go to the park, whatever. Now it's like, everything's online, you build your life online, you game online, you do everything, and it's... there's nothing that can replace a human interaction. And unfortunately, like, all interviews are going to be face to face. So if you're lacking that in life, you get to interview, you're not going to know how to present yourself to another person. So it's very risky. I don't know how we're going to solve that.
Because imagine, like, you were the teenager now when you had to go to Stoke. Remember the culture shock? Like, you were able to hack it then.
Yeah.
But let's say, like, someone now was to go and do that. It might be completely different.
And I have a lot of sympathy for teenagers now because they're not allowed to make mistakes in peace.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Like,
it's true.
When we were younger, we can make mistakes. It wouldn't be on social media, or we wouldn't have anything to compare it to. It was just like, okay, I've made my mistake, cool, I'm gonna grow as a person. Now it's like, every little thing you do, you look online, someone has a think piece about it, you go on TikTok, people are arguing in the comments, Twitter, all of that. You don't know what to think, and you're very impressionable at that age. And then now there's just too many opinions, and you don't really know how to think. Guys think that if they don't have money, if they don't have a car by 18, if they don't have a house by 21, they're failing in life. Girls think if their bums ain't big, if they have thin waist, or if they don't have whatever, they're not good enough, because that's the standard that's set, and that's all they see, and that's the epitome of success. I really feel for the mental health of teenagers, and if I was a parent right now, I would just do my best to try and, like, just let them know what is a good core value in a human, both physically and mentally.
Yeah.
But it's so hard because kids spend so much time away from you. How are you going to battle that? It's so hard, like, honestly.
And just, like, my sister, she's turning 15, she is on her phone so much.
25-8.
You literally can't, like, take it away from her because she doesn't see her friends often. Like, they don't really go out that much. Like, they do, but not, like, we'd go to the park every day and just play football. Now, if they meet up, they meet up to just chat and, they don't play. And
I don't know, it's become...
It's mostly not their fault, I think.
No,
on top of that, things have been monetized. I don't know if you can remember when I said I had like a youth club and a football club when I was younger. It was all free. Do you know what I mean?
Now they're
knocking them down, and if you want to play on a pitch, you have to book it. Imagine being 13 years of age asking mum for £7 to play an hour of football. No. But do you know what I mean? Yeah. But like, where are they going to go? On their phones.
Yeah. Or
like, kids have energy, they need an outlet. Like, if they want to dance, all these dance classes and groups and cheerleading groups, they're so expensive. I really feel sorry for teenagers in this capitalist society, without getting too deep into it, but like, where are they going to go and what they're going to do? All they have is their phones as an outlet, which is not a natural outlet.
Yeah, because you can go on TikTok and start doing a dance, and everyone's dancing with you, and you're just dancing. Like,
but then in real life, like, you're too scared to say hello to that person that you were 100%. On live to.
Yeah.
But you mentioned like your core values and stuff.
Yeah.
What are like your main core values and something some things that are non-negotiable to you? For example, it could be personal life or work life.
I'll start with personal, non-negotiable. I see myself as a generous person, a nice person, and whilst I don't need that reciprocated, I like that to be respected and not taken advantage of. And I've had a few instances in my life where that's been taken advantage of, people taking advantage of my time.
You said that in such a nice way, by the way. Like, it's such a, like, because I feel like in your head I know what you wanted to say.
Yeah, exactly. And I just feel like I like to be respected. I don't ever like to be looked down on.
Mm-hmm.
I know my qualities, and I feel like I'm nice, but I care about people, and just don't cross that line.
Don't take the piss. Yeah.
Punctuality, I guess.
Honestly, I've had arguments with friends and family about punctuality.
Punctuality for
but
me.
You know, they say the people who are late are more the most successful, apparently.
Really?
I don't know.
Honestly.
How did they study that?
Maybe it comes from a place of not caring.
Yeah. And it's like, you know, there's also say the younger child usually is the most successful because there is less attention on them.
Yeah, because the older child's made the mistakes or at least has taken all the flack.
They've got all the light on them, yeah.
Yeah, 100%.
Stephen Bartlett was actually saying that as well.
Stephen Bartlett.
I know. That's
the oldest.
Yeah, oldest.
Another non-negotiable. You've stumped me here. Always speak kindly to yourself. It's hard. And sometimes unnatural, but always speak kindly to yourself. Whatever situation, don't talk yourself down. Don't talk yourself negatively into something. Like me and T, my girlfriend, we have a lot of conversations about money sometimes. And sometimes she will say that, oh, I can't afford to do this, or she'll say she's broke. She's not broke.
Our version of broke is not broke.
Yeah, but then it's just having a negative.
Yeah, yeah, no.
She doesn't mean it.
Yeah.
And she's only done it a handful of times. But I'm like, no, you're just choosing not to do that thing because it's not a priority. Do you know what I mean? Like your priority. Like, she saves so well, and then obviously sometimes when you save, you don't have enough money to do the nice to have. That doesn't mean you're broke.
Yeah.
Like, that's just a recent example I could give, but. Talking down or saying you're just the something, I just work in this, or I'm just doing this, you're talking down to yourself, and people sense that,
definitely.
And bring you down as well.
Yeah.
So talking nicely to yourself without being toxic positive is a key thing for me. I will teach that to my children. Speak nicely to yourself and people will be kind to you or good to you and won't walk all over you, which can't happen in this life. From a professional point of view, I never work past my hours. My 9 to 5, I try and work smart. I need my own personal life, my personal time. And whilst I am working, to do the best that I can. And also follow your passions. By that I mean, if you like to draw, if you like to sing, whatever, do it. You don't have to be good at it. Learn something new as well. Yeah. Get out of your comfort zone. I talk about tea a lot, sorry. But she's taken up rollerblading recently. And she's done nunchucking recently. And every time she does something new, I'm really proud because...
She's always doing something.
Yeah, she's always doing something. And she sticks to certain things as well. But she's a great learner. Mm. And she is not... She's one of the best people I've seen stepping out of their comfort zone. And just doing it for the sake of it. Not to be good at it. Eventually she's good at it. So I think in that sense, it's really good to learn a new skill and try and stick with it as well. Have to love being alone. Have to love your own company, and that stuck with me till today. I don't know if T sometimes told you, but I go to cafes and pubs alone for a few hours at a time.
I do that.
Go alone. I have a draw. I read. I put my phone away first and foremost, but I do things that don't involve the outside world, just to lock off and be comfortable in my own company. And that time taught me that once I love myself, once I love being alone, once I've identified my strengths, I'm unstoppable. Like, because if I'm fully confident in who I am, whilst knowing my flaws, and I show that, there's no one that can say no to me. No one. And if they do, so be it. Cool, I'm bulletproof. On to the next one.
Is that something you've always kind of just had with you, or is it something you've learned?
Something I've learned.
Yeah.
You're not born loving yourself, and you're not born with that confidence, but you get to a point where you're like, I have something that no one else has, and that's just been me. once you see that as a strength and not a burden, nothing can stop you, honestly. And if there's not, there's you, like they used to say in football, we don't lose, we learn. If an opportunity closes, you learn from it, you go on to the next one. Mm-hmm. Sometimes we beat ourselves up because we didn't get it, but then we realise years later, that was a blessing in disguise, you know? So as long as you learn to love yourself, love your own company, identify your strengths, acknowledge your weaknesses. I'm trying to say this at least cringe possible, but it's so true.
Fine. Everyone needs to hear it, honestly, because I feel like everyone's so scared of failing and losing and stumbling that they don't even make it to where they get to try. They just give up before. And obviously it is the time, like the day and age now, where it's very daunting to maybe, like, it seems very daunting to get into a certain industry or do something new, because honestly even this for me is super super daunting. But like you said, and it kind of like resonates so much with me when you say doing something that you love is so important, because like when I'm 80 or when I'm in my deathbed, I'm only going to regret the things I didn't do.
100%. And there's a lot of cliches out there, but they're so true. So to answer your question, love yourself, love being alone, love identifying and discovering parts of yourself, and just be fearless. It doesn't matter if something doesn't work, it will shape you and make you a better person.
Love that. Thank you so much, Loick, for joining us. Honestly, I didn't expect it to be this insightful, in the sense of, like, I thought it was going to be more like football talk. But Elsa did say you're very well spoken, and
for you to take part in the podcast, I was like, I don't know how to you just need to
I don't know how to describe him, but just put him on, like, you're gonna love it. And I was like going through your stuff, so maybe that's why I was a little bit more, I'd shaped the idea of you that you're gonna be just like sport based, the conversation. So in my head I was like, okay, I need to know as much as I can about that industry. But honestly, it was really insightful, because I think it's probably one of the most relatable conversations that 100%. Like we've had on this episode, and especially to the viewers as well. Like young people really need someone, or not just someone, but loads of people that they can relate to. And hearing this and saying, like, it is okay to fail, it is okay to change and do something else. Like, especially in London, where it's a minority, but it's the majority. The minority is the majority in London, and we are that. And 100%. It's a good mirror to kind of like put in front of people and say, listen, if we've done it, it's doable.
And I love how you said that when you were, was it 25, 26, when your aunt's house, you can even afford her rent. I love that you said that, and because a lot of people, especially at that age, are like, oh my God, I haven't made it. I'm at this age, what is going on?
Exactly.
But it's okay.
It's okay, honestly. We're all on our own journey, and it's tough with social media, Instagram. You see people's highlights, you think, okay, they've got their shit together. You don't know what people did to even get to that post or whatever, or what they're doing. So as long as you just stay in your own lane with a good network that can help you grow, ignore the noise,
and
just go on your own path. It doesn't matter what age.
That's true.
Yeah.
Well, thank you so
thank
much.
Thank you so
Loick.
My much.
Pleasure. I'm sure we'll have you on here again.
Definitely. Anytime. It's flown
thank
by.
Thank you.
Just,
guys, thank you so much for watching episode 5. Peace out.
Woo. Bye.